Welcome to the World Beyond Belief. My name is Paul Marco, and again today we're privileged to have with us Eric Karlstrom. Now, Eric and I set this interview up because he had been doing some deep research into Alan Dulles. And a lot of people, including me, don't know to the extent to which Alan Dulles was involved in creating this problem that we're struggling with the New World Order now. So I'm going to welcome Eric to the World Beyond Belief and have him just get started on on what he's found. Hi, Eric. Welcome to World Beyond Belief.
Yeah, good morning, Paul. It's great to be talking to you again across our continents here, you in Ecuador right. And me in Colorado.
Right.
And the subject of Alan Dulles is, I've been working on this article about him, off and on for a number of months. And Alan Dulles, of course, was the first head of the CIA under Eisenhower between 1953 and 1961. So he was America's spy master during the beginning of the Cold War. And, his brother, John Foster Dulles, at the same time was Secretary of State. So the two of them probably exercised a lot more power. Well, there's no doubt that they exercised a lot more power than President Eisenhower, who was, like most of our presidents, a puppet. Now, the reason that I've found this subject so important is that I have begun to realize through my reading and my research that the CIA runs our country.
Yeah.
And has run our country ever since it was formed back in 1947. That means all of our lives, Paul, pretty much, we have had a system that is run by intelligence agencies on behalf of course, Wall Street, the City of London, the international bankers, the global power structure. Now, you and I have done some very interesting interviews, and we've featured the Tavistock Institute out of Britain. Well, of course, it was MI6, Britain's MI6, that created our OSS, Office of Strategic Services, right near the tail end of World War II, which morphed into the CIA. So the Anglo-American alliance has been operating on many levels for well over a century. Before we get into it, let me just mention for the benefit of our listeners that I have an article on my 911nwo.com website, which is now quite extensive. And the article is called Alan Dulles, America's Greatest Spy Master and Traitor. And then semicolon, Illuminati Agentur. In this article, which I've recently posted on this website, and I would again invite your listeners to go to that article and follow along, check it out. The research that I did for this article is kind of embarrassingly simple-minded. What I've done over the years is collect a lot of books and read them. Uh-huh. And this is, of course, when one does this, one realizes that a lot of books are very much on the level and the researchers are genuinely interested in uncovering the truth, which sometimes can be hazardous to your health.
Right.
I can talk about the ones that have been, I think, offed. And then there's a whole, probably more books, which are what we might call limited hangouts, mm-hmm. that the CIA itself would have sponsored or other financial interests to confuse, to poison the well, as it were. So we're always dealing with this difficult, challenging mix of information and disinformation. And that's how intelligence agencies maintain their power and control. Now, just for kind of interest's sake, there's an interesting movie called The Good Shepherd, which I watched just a couple nights ago. Matt Damon plays a character very much like Alan Dulles, and it's very loosely patterned on his early life. But of course, again, there's so much that's not true or not appropriate for Alan Dulles that one can't really get a good sense of who Alan Dulles is, except kind of on a visceral, emotional level. One can. And there's a great line in there. I don't have the quote right in front of me. It's somewhere in my on my website under the New World Religion question mark, in which the senior British spy says to the junior American spy, more or less Alan Dulles, you know, it's this the black arts is what we in the you know, the British aristocracy, this is our mother's milk, and this is how we control our empire. And the way that we do this, and we hate to share it with you Americans, but we need your help in World War II, so we're going to have to share it with you.
Right.
And the way we do this, it's manipulating the balance of information and disinformation. And in so doing, therein lies power. Power is the ability to confuse, to give false perceptions, which of course our media does all the time, and our propaganda system. And many, many of our books, thanks to CIA's Operation Mockingbird, which goes way back to the 50s, in which they spent over $1 billion to more or less control the storyline that our press, our media was putting out. Alan Dulles himself, as we'll get into, had tremendous contacts in the press, including the New York Times, the Washington Post. You know, he was a famous philanderer. He slept with a lot of the wives of, you know, like Henry Luce, who was editor of Time magazine and who proclaimed the American century back in the 50s. And it was the Dulles brothers, really, who implemented this American empire. Again, the 1-2 punch, John Foster Dulles, head of Secretary of State under Eisenhower, and Alan Dulles, head of the CIA. But going back to this information, disinformation interplay, this is all by way of introduction to our interview. Let me just read a smidge from our friend Dr. John Coleman, who's MI6, that is to say British intelligence, former British intelligence, and wrote a book on Tavistock Institute of Human Relations, shaping the moral, spiritual, cultural, political, and economic decline of the United States of America. He says, in 2003, Bush the Younger followed very closely the formula that had succeeded for his father, but with some additional adaptations. News mixed with fiction became more fiction mixed with news. And blatant lying was resorted to so that straight reporting became impossible to distinguish from news adulterated with fiction. He goes on, talks about, you know, the cooked intelligence from that came, you know, that justified the Iraq War in 2003. And then he talks about the scripted, the incubator baby story that Hill and Knowlton put together to help get us into the first Gulf War in 1991. All this stuff, of course, is fabricated lies, propaganda, but it's very effective when the media gets a hold of these things and then keeps repeating it, and then the American people get sucked in. And I'll just pick up a few paragraphs later. Later, a dire threat was added that Iraq had the capability to strike at the U.S. with long-range weapons of mass destruction. It was the adaptation of Stalin's edict that to capture and enslave your own people, first terrorize them. Well, we see this through history, and certainly you and I grew up with the duck and cover.
Yeah.
We were kids, you know, and the nuclear threat was very real. I was in Washington, D.C. in 1962 during the Cuban Missile Crisis, and, you know, all this was played out on the loudspeaker in my junior high school, and my classmates and I said, well, you know, goodbye.
Yeah. You know,
we're going to die.
Yeah.
And This was very kind of, you know, pivotal and traumatic. And then, of course, the next year, the Kennedy assassination, which, as we'll see, Alan Dulles was probably the chairman of the board of the Kennedy assassination, even though he had been fired by Kennedy in 1961 for the failed Bay of Pigs invasion into Cuba. Yeah. In fact, I think the way it played out, and many will agree, is that Alan Dulles kept his post even though he'd been fired and was still manipulating the CIA. And a couple years later, he fired John F. Kennedy in return because Kennedy had made so many powerful enemies, and Dulles was always kind of a team player, so we'll get into that too.
Yeah.
But all this is by way of introduction, Paul. I'm sorry to be so wordy, but going back to my article, which I really would like people to consult, because there's no way to understand this stuff unless one reads widely. And let me just pick up a couple. I've got all of this article comes from about 45 books that are on my shelf. And I have figured out, I think, I hope, the difference between the truth and propaganda when it comes to the story, main storyline of the 20th century. And of course, leading up to the present. And I believe I've judiciously chosen quotes from about 40, 45 books that cool. In this article, direct quotes from these other authors who are researchers. I'm just the compiler here.
Uh-huh.
I'm a retired guy, 66. I was a physical geographer. I don't want to go out and do original research. It's not what I'm into. But I am interested in the truth.
Right.
And what I find is that each of these good books will contain nuggets of truth, but that you have to assemble them from a lot of different sources to get the big picture.
Right.
So that's what I've tried to do here. And I feel like coming to grips with, say, Alan Dulles' life story is a very excellent way of understanding the power structure and how America has been co-opted. Uh-huh. To become the American empire, and of course to fight all these foreign wars of aggression, to topple all these nationalistic leaders that after World War II tried to share the resources of their country with their own people, such as Jacobo Arbenz, he was removed from office by a CIA coup in 1954. He was just a nationalist reformer who wanted to give a little bit of land to the poverty-stricken Guatemalans. I've been to Guatemala 5 times, and I have an affinity for those people. I like them. But the American ruling class just was happy as a clam to take out Jacobo Arbenz in a CIA-orchestrated coup, put in Armas, who was a American puppet, who initiated death squads, and our Guatemala became a killing fields.
Yeah.
200,000 to 300,000 peasants, Guatemala peasants, were killed in the police state, which America set up in Guatemala to protect the interests of United Fruit Company, which was kind of one of the biggest of the corporations down there, and had controlled Guatemalan politics all along. So that it was a puppet. Well, guess who sat on the board of directors of United Fruit? Well, Alan Dulles and John Foster Dulles. So here you have two guys, and I'm kind of losing my thread. Let me first of all go back to my where I get the information. I'll just pick up a couple of the books. Like I say, over 40. These are my sources, okay? Here is Coburn and St. Clair. 1992, something like that. Whiteout, the CIA drugs and the press. Here is William Engdahl. I've got several of his books. Full Spectrum Dominance, Totalitarian Democracy in the New World Order. Another one by Engdahl, Oil, Iraq, and the Future of the Dollar. The title, Petrodollar Warfare. No, excuse me, this is William Clark. Petrodollar Warfare is the title, Oil, Iraq, and the Future of the Dollar. Here is Christopher Simpson's The Splendid Blonde Beast, Money, Law, and Genocide in the 20th Century. Here is our friend Carol Quigley, professor of political science at Georgetown, who wrote this book's called The Anglo-American Establishment, and that's what we're dealing with here. Likewise, William Engdahl, A Century of War, Anglo-American Oil Politics and the New World Order. Here is William Blum, former State Department, Killing Hope, U.S. Military and CIA Interventions Since World War II. This will kill your hope reading this book of how many countries and leaders the U.S. has destroyed. Now, Alan Dulles really set the tone, but obviously these policies have kept going to the present. It's called the American Empire. Here's The Devil's Chessboard, a quite recent book last year by David Talbot, the subtitle, Alan Dulles, the CIA, and the Rise of America's Secret Government. Now, I've actually got this on audio tape, and I've been listening to it. And I've read so much now, I can tell you when he's concealing information.
Cool.
So here's the exhaustive book on Alan Dulles, and in some ways it's a limited hangout. He is he's telling you some information, and he's leaving things out.
Right.
Okay, so half a truth, it can be worse than a whole lie. So anyway,
exactly.
I'm interested in that, but I don't believe any of these books, so I triangulate with all of them to the extent that I can. Now here's on I.G. Farben, the huge conglomerate chemical corporation of Germany that really backed Hitler financially, and it was all tied up with Rockefeller Standard Oil. So it was really Rockefeller, I.G. Farben. And of course, the Dulles brothers were the lawyers for I.G. Farben and Rockefeller and Schroeder Bank in Germany and all of these interests. They were directors of all these major corporations, and Alan Dulles was the spy master, and John Foster Dulles was the Secretary of State that advanced the interest of these corporations. So we've had a corporate rule in America, and Alan Dulles and John Foster Dulles were extremely effective operatives for that system. This book's called Hell's Cartel, I.G. Farben and the Making of Hitler's War Machine by Diarmuid Jeffries. Now, these are just some of them, but I'll go through. Here's Inside I.G. Farben, Hecht During the Third Reich, Stefan H. Lindner. Okay, here's our friend Daniel Estulin, Tavistock Institute, Social Engineering and the Masses. This is an important book and one of the few books that has actually been stolen from my library while I was out. This one's called Secret Agenda, The United States Government, Nazi Scientists, and Project Paperclip, 1945 to 1990, by Linda Hunt. Linda Hunt did a lot of good research on Operation Paperclip, by which the Dulles brothers and others were able to smuggle out top Nazi scientists and war criminals after World War II. And then they have infiltrated our scientific and medical establishments and our government. This is a very important book that costs about $100. It's you can get it. It's The New Underworld Order, Triumph of Criminalism, Dark Actors Playing Games, The Global Fantasies of the Geomasonic Illuminati. This is by a very, very well-educated fellow named Christopher Story. Who's a Englishman, well-educated, and also an economic journalist. I believe he was probably poisoned in the United States in 2010. These are big, fat books, and I've read them.
Right.
at least many of them. Now, John Stockwell is the highest CIA operative ever to go public. He was involved as an agent, station chief in Vietnam, and also in Uganda, I believe. Nor was it the Congo. Yeah, the Congo. Of course, Patrice Lumumba was assassinated by the CIA under Alan Dulles. Again, trying to share his resources in this country with his people. As the Belgian colonialists were being kicked out after World War II, well, the U.S. would make sure that the colonial system was maintained in actual fact, and American hegemony, American empire, American interest, corporate interest would be represented, which required that these nationalistic leaders like Patrice Lumumba be assassinated or otherwise removed. And John F. Kennedy didn't even know. See, this is how out of the loop presidents are.
Right.
Kennedy did not know that Alan Dulles and the CIA had assassinated Lumumba until 2 months or 3 months later. And this was just as soon as he got into power. So Alan Dulles was always in charge under the Eisenhower administration. He even said, Eisenhower has surrendered his power to me. That's a direct quote from Alan
Dulles. Alan Dulles, wow.
Okay, so anyway, John Stockwell has done some good writing. He was a very, very high CIA guy, and he's come out saying that the Third World War in the Third World after World War II has killed over 6 million people, and this is the secret wars of the CIA in effect. And again, John Stockwell, you can YouTube this guy, and most of these guys you can get on YouTube or you can read their books. They have a wealth of good information. Jim Mars is pretty good. He gets into too much in the way of Anunnaki and spacemen for my taste, but he's got a good book, The Rise of the Fourth Reich, The Secret Societies That Threatened to Take Over America. A lot of good information about the Nazis there. James Randall Noblett and Pamela Sue Perskin, Cult and Ritual Abuse, The History, Anthropology, and Recent Discovery in Contemporary America. That becomes important because MKUltra and other mind control operations were really overseen and started by the CIA under Alan Dulles. And Alan Dulles did send his namesake, his oldest son, to one of these CIA psychiatrists after he had, after this young man had returned from Korea with brain damage because he had gotten some shrapnel in his skull, wounded. And there's old Alan Dulles sending his own son off to these monster psychiatrists. He also tried to send his wife Clover to Ewan Campbell, who was one of the really monster psychiatrists from Canada, who was up in Toronto. You can read about all this stuff. Jim Keith was an excellent researcher. I think he may have been offed as well. Here's one of his many good books, Mind Control and UFOs, Casebook on Alternative 3, packed with information, as is Mind Control, World Control by Jim Keith. This is a very important book by Yaden and Hawkins. I think it's a Lulu book, which means you can get it printed. But it's probably not in bookstores. The Nazi Hydra in America, Suppressed History of a Century. Good big fat book. A lot of information there. About Alan Dulles and his activities. Nice. And here's Mark Zeprazauer, The CIA's Greatest Hits. This is a very short book, easy to read, and very small representation of the CIA's hits. By the way, Stockwell and others refer to the Church Committee hearings in 1976 and 77, Senate hearings, in which it was revealed that the CIA at that time had conducted over 10,000 covert operations, every one of them illegal. And of course, 1977 to today is another 40 years almost. And I'm sure they've done more than that. Acid Dreams, The Complete Social History of LSD, the CIA, the 60s and Beyond by Lee and Schlein. It's a well-researched book by Charles Higham, The Exposé of the Nazi American Money Plot of 1933 to 1949, Trading with the Enemy. And this talks about how the Bush family, the Harriman family, the Rockefeller family, and of course the Dulleses as prominent lawyers for Sullivan and Cromwell, which is Wall Street's premier legal firm for the robber barons, the Rockefellers, how they, over 300 corporations in America were trading with Hitler when World War II broke out. So in other words, we'll get to the Hitler project and the German experiment soon, because Hitler and the Nazis were created by the Anglo-American establishment. Fascism there was fueled by our eugenics research by the Rockefellers, just like this same group created the Bolshevik Revolution. So you have this same group creating the monsters of communism in Russia and China, which, you know, killed upwards of 200 million of their own people if you add them together. And then they also created the Nazis, which is, of course, the right-wing version of of totalitarian government or top-down revolution, if you will, fascism, which has now come to the United States a big time. Here's a book by Lincoln Lawrence, came out just a few years after Kennedy died. This is an excellent book after the Kennedy assassination, called Were We Controlled? The Assassination of Kennedy, and he talks about some of the mind, very sophisticated mind control technologies that were used even back in 1963. This is a pseudonym, Lincoln Lawrence. It was dangerous to write books like that at the time if you used your real name. Mass Control, Engineering Human Consciousness, Jim Keith. Again, he died too young. Terrorism and the Illuminati, 3,000-year history by David Livingston. He's a Canadian who's a Muslim, interestingly enough, and writes some very interesting things about history. Blowback by Christopher Simpson, the first full account of America's recruitment of Nazis and its disastrous effect on our domestic and foreign policy. Here's an interesting one by Guido Giacomo Preparata, Conjuring Hitler, How Britain and America Made the Third Reich. We'll see that that's the case. Fletcher Prouty was in the CIA between 1955 and 1963. He wrote a book, he's actually in the movie JFK, his character is. It's called The Secret Team. Now get this subtitle. The CIA and its allies in control of the United States and the world. This is a guy who was in the CIA and knew Allen Dulles and knew these people. So that's what you call, you know, the real deal, I think. Another one, Gangs of America, The Rise of Corporate Power and the Disabling of Democracy. One more I'll throw up there is... Okay. Gang Stalking and Mind Control, The Destruction of Society Through Community Spying Networks, A.K. Forwood. If you want to know about gang stalking, you can print this short book up from Lulu, $10. And this is, again, the subtitle, very revealing, The Destruction of Society Through Community Spying Networks. Well, all of this stuff comes from somewhere. And Allen Dulles' life is an excellent place to start to understand where we are today. Again, Allen Dulles and his brother John Foster, prominent lawyers with Sullivan and Cromwell, the number one legal firm for the robber barons. Now you look at the lives, and this is in my article. Look at the lives of these guys. They were obviously born into, well, before I do that, let me just get a couple quotes here, if you'll forgive me. I showed you the book by Yadin and Hawkins about the Nazi Hydra in America. In that, it's just a provocative sentence. Direct actions taken by the Harriman-Busch shipping line in 1932. This is, of course, between World War I and World War II. And by the Dulles brothers in January 1933 are the two gravest and most treasonous actions ever taken against the United States and humanity in the 20th century. Those actions led directly to the seizure of power by the Nazis, placing the burden for World War II squarely on the shoulders of Harriman, Bush, and the Dulles brothers. Unequivocally, John Foster Dulles, Allen Dulles, Prescott Bush, and Averill Harriman were the most flagrant in providing aid for the Nazis. Not only did they help Hitler seize power, their actions also facilitated other American aid to the Nazis. Bush and Harriman acted as Hitler's American banker, operating a company, Brown Brothers Harriman and Union Banking Company, that was the center of the Nazis' espionage ring in the United States. The Nazis were spying on us before World War II, and the Nazis being a creation of the Anglo-American Alliance, or the elite anyway.
Sure.
Once it was clear that the war was imminent, the Dulles brothers attempted to hide, to cloak the Nazi investments of their clients. So 70% of the investments from Wall Street between World War I and World War II were in the Nazi German war machine in order to concoct World War II. Once it was clear that the war was imminent, the Dulles brothers attempted to cloak Now these guys are financial wizards. They're hiding all these deals. Mm-hmm. Very clever at that. And of course, one guy then becomes Secretary of State, and one guy becomes head of the CIA. Then they can really make it stick. This is from Glenn Yeadon and John Hawkins, 2007, The Nazi Hydra in America, Suppressed History of a Century. Here's from James Jesus Angleton, the CIA chief of counterintelligence, who was the guy who was the liaison to the Vatican and who was the main liaison to the Mossad, the CIA-trained Mossad. He said, Alan Dulles, Richard Helms, Carmel Offey, and Frank Wisner were the grand masters. If you were in a room with them, you were in a room full of people that you had to believe would deservedly end up in hell. I guess I will see them there soon. Well, a little candor, here's what Fletcher Prouty said, the guy who worked in the CIA, wrote The Secret Team, the CIA and its allies in control of the United States and the world. The CIA's control of security within this country, even more than elsewhere, is nearly absolute. Of course, what follows from this is the ability to make and to control the foreign policy and military policy-making machinery of this country. And then you have another ex-CIA guy. This is from Michael Collins Piper's book, Final Judgment, The Missing Link in the JFK Assassination Conspiracy. I'm convinced that John Kennedy was assassinated largely by Alan Dulles, this is not by Michael Collins Piper. This is by an ex-CIA guy whose name will come to me in a second. He said this recently in an interview. I'm convinced that John Kennedy was assassinated largely by Alan Dulles, whom he fired as the head of the CIA after the Bay of Pigs, and a coterie of Joint Chiefs of Staff, FBI, and even some Secret Service folks. This is by retired CIA analyst Ray McGovern in 2013 on a radio interview, WBAI Law and Order. And then Michael Collins Piper, in his Final Judgment book, said, Israel's global network had the power to orchestrate not only the assassination of Kennedy, but also the subsequent cover-up. Israel was indeed a key player in the JFK assassination conspiracy, and the evidence suggests the primary instigator of the crime. So, another great quote, treason doth never prosper. What's the reason? Why? If it prosper, none dare call it treason.
That's a good way to look at it.
That's by Sir John Harrington, Epigrams, Book 4, Epigram 5. So this guy, Alan Dulles, he and his brother were born to a very, it's not a rich family, but very well-connected family. His uncle, I think two of his uncle and father-in-law were Secretary of States. If the first part of this thing, I talk about the family history here. So they're connected to the global elite with their cousins and in-laws with the Rockefellers. They're intermarried with these spy master families from Switzerland. They were nephews of the Secretary of State, Robert Lansing. One of their relatives supposedly brought Scottish Rite of Freemasonry to the United States. And they were strong supporters of eugenics and mind control movements and programs all along. So they were tapped very relatively young age to be actual co-founders of the Council on Foreign Relations right after World War II. So there they are with Colonel Edward Mandel House, who was the Rothschild agent, who was controlling, like a puppet master, President Woodrow Wilson, and getting us into World War I, and getting us the Federal Reserve Act of 1913. In other words, he was a one-worlder.
Yeah.
Edward Mandel House is one of these Illuminati agentur that has enormous impact on history. He's not elected ever. He's an advisor.
Yeah.
And he seems to have some kind of mental hold. Now, this is where maybe the spiritual end comes in. He seems to have a mental hold over President Woodrow Wilson. And he actually had an office in the White House. And again, Illuminati Rothschild agent from the South. He was also at that meeting in which the Council on Foreign Relations was formed. Now, the Council on Foreign Relations formed in 1921 as an American adjunct of the British Royal Institute for International Affairs,
right,
which came out of the Cecil Rhodes Roundtable Group, the Milner Group, mm-hmm, the One Worlder Group that wanted to, again, implement one world government under British control. And again, it's fairly small cabal of individuals who have,
right,
enormous power through their network, their secret societies,
right,
and their financial clout. So there were the Dulles brothers, young, taking up the mantle of Colonel Edward House, who was retiring at that time, I guess, from being on the world stage as an agenteur. The young Dulles brothers, both lawyers, and the older at this time associated with Sullivan and Cromwell, they're at the Paris Peace Conference. And they helped craft the Versailles Treaty, which had terms of reparation that were so harsh on Germany that it more or less guaranteed World War II.
Right.
So these guys were setting up World War II even as World War I closed.
Right.
And there's a banker out of London, City of London, named Tearx, who actually used the term the German experiment. And
yeah,
there are others who talk about the Hitler project. So the Hitler project, the German experiment, the creation of this fascist occult, it's a death cult, really,
right,
because it's got the OTO in it. It's got,
right,
the Helen Blavatsky Theosophy. It's got the Vril Society. It's got the Tool Society. All these satanic influences
satanic
are integrated into Hitler and his top team. And, of course, the Dulles brothers, were lawyers, but Alan Dulles in particular, even between the wars, he was in the State Department, and he was stationed in Bern, Switzerland, where he had developed all these contacts and networks with Germans. In fact, Christopher Story, who wrote the New Underworld Order, says Dulles was always a German Abwehr agent.
Yeah.
In other words, he was always a spy. He was always a double, triple, quadruple agent,
right,
not only for Britain, he was MI6, but he was also a spy with the Germans, and he was a spy with and for eventually with his cooperation with,
exactly,
with Israel's Mossad. So here's a guy whose allegiances are really to no country, but to the bankers whom he served as in the capacity of lawyer,
right,
and spy. And
I think we should mention how this cabal set up World War II. And
right,
you can tell me if I'm wrong, but it seems to me that the Versailles Treaty totally crippled and made Germany non-functional. It disarmed the people and put them so much in debt that they could no longer function. Then Alan Dulles and the boys come in with all this money and bankroll Hitler and create IG Farben, which is Hitler, according to Anthony Sutton. So it's like they created the chaos, then they created the order for the other. You know, you have to have two sides in a war, so you have to
exactly,
make sure they have guns and stuff.
Absolutely, and you've got it. You know, these are techniques, I think, of manipulating countries, manipulating people. Obviously, this has happened in Britain. You know, this was a pretty Christian country. The Magna Carta comes from Britain.
From Britain, yeah.
You know, in the 11th century, I believe. So there's this kind of Christian impulse, which gets taken over, you know, in the 1600s, 1700s, as the Bank of England comes in. And that's, of course, controlled by the Rothschild family. Germany also was a stalwart country, really. I think in a lot of ways, the people were very industrious, still are, and
still are.
Britain wanted to take down that potential threat, and that was one way to do it, was to pit Germany against the Soviet Union. And the great game, you know, from the British point of view, Halford Mackinder, this geographer, geopolitician in Britain, always talked about how the real war was between Britain and Russia for control of Eurasia, which has two-thirds of the world's population and two-thirds of the world's resources. So all of this then is manipulation of countries by, you know, the power elite so that they control the resources and they take out their enemies. They first they create and then they take out
And they
out
take
their
them
enemies.
Out, yeah.
Yeah, so Hitler, the Germans were victim of this system twice. World War I and World War II. So you almost feel sorry for, you do feel sorry for
right.
the rank and file Germans. But on the other hand, the Nazi party, it's hard to feel sorry for those guys. Well, right. then Alan Dulles, of course, has all these contacts with Switzerland and Austria and Germany going into World War II. And he's a spy over there during World War II. He is... at that time, you know, he becomes a member of the young OSS, which is the precursor to the CIA. And so the Rockefellers would have had all these financial arrangements with IG Farben and the Schroeder Bank and all these German cartels, as well as British. And Alan Dulles, obviously very clever fellow.
yeah.
Obviously very smart. Obviously very charming, obviously very determined.
I could say demonically possessed, too, knowing that he's bloodline and belongs to all these secrets.
I think that's probably an accurate observation. The people that have profiled him, like Talbot in his book about the devil's chessboard, you know, they say he's a psychopath, you know.
Yeah.
And psychopath doesn't feel guilt or doesn't have a conscience.
No.
And he said he would brag that he was probably the only person in Washington that could knowingly send somebody to their death. And, of course, he did on a regular basis.
Kennedy.
He had,
Kennedy.
the president of the United
yeah,
States.
Yeah, that's right.
Others. And then he would, you know, sleep with all kinds of other, you know, attractive spies in Europe, and some of them would get wrong-sided with the, you know, the CIA, and he just let them get offed, you know.
Offed, yeah.
It's no big deal, you know, because it's always this milking everybody for any tidbit of information that could help the grand spy master, you know, orchestrate things.
Right.
So Hitler is set up by what I'll call the Rockefeller, Harriman, Bush, Dulles faction. And we have to see Alan Dulles as a very, very clever representative of this corporate world that sets up Hitler. And right after, and of course, during World War II, FDR, Roosevelt, wanted Germany to completely surrender unconditionally after World War II. Alan Dulles, meanwhile, sets up a separate peace in Italy called Operation Sunrise, in which he gets with one of the Nazis named Karl Wolf, and they set up a separate set of kind of terms of the surrender, which actually leave the Nazis with a lot of power. It allows the Nazis to escape, you know, through the rat lines on Operation Paperclip to South America and the Americas and take a lot of their money with them.
Yeah.
And these business arrangements then are maintained by Dulles and his clients with guys like Martin Bormann, the number two man at and so after World War II, you have the Nazi Internationale operating globally now with, again, contacts to American corporate interests. Again, courtesy of Alan Dulles and his networks.
Mm-hmm.
So here is a guy, this Alan Dulles, who helped set up World War II. Of course, killed about 60 or 70 million people. And, of course, devastated them. The United States, is, even though the United States came out as number one wealthiest country after World War II, And then he maintained his spy network with Britain and the Nazis after World War II. And then it was really the Dulles brothers and Reinhard Gehlen, who was the top spy master, the German spy master on the Eastern Front, that is, of the Soviets. The Gehlen organization was subsumed into the new CIA right from the start. So our CIA was always a mixture of ex-Nazis and American Ivy Leaguers, Princeton, Yale, yeah. Harvard graduates, smart people, often intellectual and liberal, who tended to be selected by the CIA. Mm-hmm. And Fletcher Prouty has some very interesting comments. Again, Fletcher Prouty, the ex-CIA guy himself, who said that, you know, there is a legitimate function in a government to collecting information and intelligence. And, of course, that's what was sold to President Truman when he passed the National Security Act in 1947. But Truman was very cautious and leery of a runaway covert organization that would do all these illegal covert ops. So he wanted to hold them to the fire, at least that's the story. But guys like Dulles, they really got turned on by the covert ops. That's what, you know, that's what made them sure. really happy. And so Prouty says, actually, if Dulles has his way, which of course he did, the ratio of covert ops, you know, taking down foreign leaders, insurrections, coups, things like that, to intelligence gathering would be about 90% covert ops and 10% intelligence gathering. Whereas mm-hmm. Prouty says it should be the other way around. It should be mostly intelligence gathering, you know, and the covert ops, again, are illegal, extra legal. They've always been extra legal. They're illegal anywhere. And the CIA's charter said it couldn't operate in the United States. Well, it's been operating in the United States yeah. ever since it was formed, right. illegally.
Right.
And our generation was spied on in Operation Chaos in, you know, during the 60s, because they yeah. wanted to see kind of a playback thing, how their operations, like Laurel Canyon, all the hippie counterculture,
right.
how that was disempowering the anti-Vietnam War protests. Well, to go back to the Vietnam War, which was so pivotal and devastating in our generation, in my generation, it was a CIA operation from the beginning, starting in about 1952 with Edward Lansdale going over there. Obviously, the French were being kicked out by the Vietnamese, and it was a colonial situation. The United States, again, wanted to move in to be the new master of the third world country and its resources. They, again, used the anti-communism excuse. Oh, you know,
sure.
and of course, Ho Chi Minh was always writing letters to our president, quoting, you know, our Declaration of Independence and our Constitution, saying, hey, we want to do that here. Will
right.
you be our friends, you know?
Right.
We want you to be our friend. And he had been educated in France. You know, he knew something about Marxism, but basically he just wanted to be a nationalist and share the resources of his country with his people, like Mossadegh did
right.
in Iran and like Arbenz did in Guatemala. You go down the list of all these countries that were destabilized and destroyed and kept in their poverty to be, you know, a resource for the American empire.
Yeah.
And anyway, going back to Vietnam, it wasn't until 1964 that the U.S. Army and other military forces actually sent people over there. Between 52 and 64, it was always a secret covert operation by the CIA, and part of that included taking over the drug trade, which of course the French had, the French connection, Marseille,
right.
and then that was over towards you know, the Golden Triangle and the heroin and the opium out of Laos. So the American establishment and the British establishment were the same ones, the British East India Company, that they'd got a foothold in China through the Opium Wars by getting a country to to be addicted to drugs, and then they could come in and steal the resources. Well, they applied that same technique to our country in the 60s.
Right.
After the CIA had done all these experiments on LSD and found out that it was a psychosis-producing weapon of war.
Right.
And they tested all of these drugs, and CIA, they really kind of liked that. Richard Helms was the guy who took the lead on that, as well as Sidney Gottlieb of the Technical Services Division. These are the MK Ultra guys. The mind control guys, these are the real dark, dark psychopaths, because when you start playing with people's minds, you actually destroy them, I think, and you take away their soul to a large extent. They did this wholesale, and they were using Americans as guinea pigs throughout the 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, and right probably to the present.
Right.
So we're talking, you know, very satanic. This is, mind control is satanic. There's no question.
No doubt about it.
And the CIA took the experiments that the Nazis were doing under Joseph Mengele and other eugenicists and mind control monsters. And the CIA kept them going under MKUltra, often bringing the same German psychopath doctors into this country. The same guys, Joseph Mengele, were programming American youth. This is top secret stuff.
Right.
But now it's coming out. So all of this was happening under Alan Dulles, too. It was April 1953. He started in 1953, that Dulles authorized MKUltra. This was top secret. And then in 1953, on the covert side, Kermit Roosevelt, who was actually related to Teddy Roosevelt, orchestrated this coup in Iran, in which the newly elected nationalistic president of Iran, Mossadegh, was ousted by a very, very dirty CIA campaign. And of course, this was at the behest of the British, because Anglo-American oil, which became British Petroleum later, had a lock on the profits from all the oil out of Iran. And then when Mossadegh came in, he wanted to nationalize the oil and make some of the money for the people of Iran. And this was intolerable to the British. So they wanted to take him down. Well, after World War II, they had lost the sufficient clout to be able to do that. And Mossadegh actually closed the British embassy. So then the British said, well, hey, will you help us out, Alan? And and so then Dulles took over that operation. It called Operation Ajax. And this is his first year as CIA director. But of course, he'd been a spy for decades.
Sure.
And Kermit Roosevelt was the guy who was given enough CIA cash and did the dirty tricks to actually orchestrate this coup, which ousted Mossadegh. They took him out, they took him down, and they reestablished the tyrannical rule of the Shah, who is this very weak, even Roosevelt said he's a real wimp. And of course, that's perfect for the American empire, because he can be completely controlled. And then it was the CIA and the Mossad that trained his death squad security system, the SAVAK, which operated for the next 25 years in a completely totalitarian manner, but that kept the oil flowing, the profits going. See, after the CIA coup, now Standard Oil and the American oil companies were getting a 40% piece of the profits, whereas before it was all going to England. So that was, you know, this was just the greatest thing that ever happened.
Yeah.
This was really what turned on Dulles. He said the highlight of his career in the CIA was the Operation Ajax, the coup in Iran that took out democratically elected Mossadegh, and Operation PB Success the next year in 1954, which took out Jacobo Arbenz, identical situation, a nationalist trying to share the wealth of the country with his own people. That was completely intolerant.
Can't do that.
And again, both situations followed by repressive dictatorships that are puppets to the American corporate interests and resulted in widespread suffering of the people and impoverishment of the people. So that even a few years ago, if you're a Guatemalan peasant, say a Mayan descendant, and your family might make $3 a day, all of you, man and woman and six kids, picking coffee beans, $3 a day, because that's the minimum wage in Guatemala. But they weren't getting their work because in Vietnam, it was $1 a day for the whole family. So this is the end result of the American empire from the point of view of labor. In fact, I started to see it very much like the Civil War and slavery, because before the Civil War, the Southern slave owners had to take care of the slaves.
Right.
After the Civil War, they let the slaves go, and now those poor people have to take care of themselves.
Right.
So it's a better deal for the corporate masters. Well, a little bit the same thing happened when World War II happened. The British Empire was splintered. The British Empire, you know, in India and all their Commonwealth countries, actually had to kind of oversee and monitor and administrate in those countries. Well, after World War II, that system officially was torn up, but a new system was implemented in which those people in those countries were still subjugated. In fact, even worse. But now the overseeing of those countries was going to be done by tin horn dictators in those countries, answerable to the American establishment. And then their policies were going to be, their economic policy is going to be dictated by the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund.
Yep.
And if they wanted, such as Ecuador, if they wanted to, get loans, or then they had to follow these structural adjustment programs, the Washington Consensus, which is sometimes called the neoliberal reform.
Right.
So this is the soft end of totalitarian rule.
You can go
the hard end is the new conservatives, which is actually we're going to invade your country and destroy it.
Right.
So two ways to destroy your country, neoliberalism and neoconservatism, new liberalism, new conservatism, which both implement the policies of the Wall Street elite.
Oh, I was just going to say, I can see why Kermit Roosevelt, just that coup totally delighted Alan Dulles, because that was a model. You can go in, you can cause so much consternation, and what he did is he turned the people against him. And they overthrew, and Alan Dulles is now looking at a process that he can just shoot his agents in. That's why it's 90% covert operations. You know, they can control these things. Now they've gotten really sloppy. They just go in and they, you know, like they did in Ukraine. They just totally, they overthrow it. They don't even care whether it's a popular uprising or anything. But I can see, you can see how it changed right after the Shah of Iran was put in.
Yes, and one tidbit I did get out of Talbot's book about the Devil's Chessboard. While Alan Dulles is doing all these coups and insurrections and assassinations in third world countries to make those countries safe for American corporations, meanwhile, his brother John Foster, head of the State Department, is threatening countries around the world with nuclear war. We've got the bomb and you don't. And you play with us. So again, this is terrorism two ways. We're imposing terror on the world with our technological superiority. And Dulles and Eisenhower, you know, they talked about using the nuclear bomb fairly regularly. And Lyman Lemnitzer, the guy who was head of chiefs of staff during the Bay of Pigs and the Cuban Missile Crisis, these guys were wanting to go for a nuclear conflict with Russia. They were pushing for it. And Kennedy, of course, pushed back and said, no, I'm not going to do that. So this thread of, you know, this warmongering. Now, look at it from the corporate side. In the Cold War, where we propped up the Soviet Union to be the enemy.
Right.
And then the German Galen organization and the Dulles team was always feeding false intelligence to the American president saying that this, you know, enormous enemy over there is ahead of us in this and that, so we have to spend more on, you know, more nuclear weapons, etc. According to the statistics I've heard, $9 trillion were spent in the Cold War, post-World War II, Cold War period on military-industrial defense contracts.
Right.
Now, that is $9 trillion at that time was more than all other sectors of the American economy. Okay, so, and this is federal money, tax money going to these corporations. So you see that the effect for Sullivan and Cromwell's clients, the military-industrial complex, was very beneficial. This Cold War allowed Russia to penetrate and control its satellite countries in the communist second world.
Right.
We penetrated and controlled our de facto colonies in the first world. Mm-hmm. Sorry, they were in the third world, but we had control of them through our coups, et cetera, and our assassinations. So we had a bipolar world in which there was this supposedly nuclear standoff, mutually assured destruction, crackpot realism, that these rational people in the CIA who have PhDs from the best universities are talking, well, you know, if they do this, we're just going to have to, you know, we're going to have to blow them up with nuclear weapons. And of course, the idea is that this is going to be so unacceptable, you know, the other team's going to back down. Because the casualties, and of course, think about it, Soviet Union, Russia had lost, you know, upwards of 20 million or more in World War II. They didn't want to lose the rest of their population.
Right.
So they were always backing down from American threats, including, and of course, Kennedy then backed down in the Cuban Missile Crisis, made a deal with Khrushchev, which enraged the CIA and the corporate powers that be, and Lyman, Lemnitzer, and those guys. And that's when Allen Dulles was fired by Kennedy. Now, the subtext, if you watch the movie The Good Shepherd, is that this character, loosely based on Allen Dulles, who's played by Matt Damon, that it's his son who is wanting to please his dad, who divulges the word Bay of Pigs to an enemy operative, and that's why they're able to, you know, defeat the American CIA invasion in 1961 at the Bay of Pigs. Well, that, of course, is fantasy. That's fiction. The story that comes out from reading all these books, to me anyway, is that the CIA put their third team in charge of this invasion so that it would fail, and then Kennedy would have to come in with American firepower, in other words, the whole military, to protect this operation. In other words, to lure him into a war with Cuba so that the rich mafioso, Meyer Lansky and whatnot, would be able to take back their little island where they could have, you know, their whorehouses and strip joints and casinos in Havana again, you know. So it didn't work. Kennedy was very strong in some ways, much stronger than he was supposed to be, and very smart.
Yeah.
And he outraged the power elite, and eventually, of course, they took him out.
They took him out
publicly. Very publicly, and you know, whether it's you know, so Piper says it's the Mossad that led it, a lot of people say it's CIA that led it, some people say the mafia led it. Obviously, it was a mix of all kinds of interests, including corporate interests that ultimately backed it. You know, was the shooter team the JM Wave team that Dulles had set up to assassinate leaders that was located in Miami, that in fact took out foreign leaders? Or was it a bunch of Corsicans that the Mossad controlled? Well, you know, it's going to be hard to, we still don't know for sure after all these years, but it was obviously a hit. And again, Allen Dulles, according to Talbot's book, even though he was kicked out in 1961, he had so many contacts. And he was, at that weekend, he was actually in the main CIA bunker, which was outside of Langley, in a place called The Farm. So all weekend long, while Kennedy's getting assassinated, and then Ruby's getting assassinating Oswald, he's in control, just like Cheney was in the bunker during 9/11. So these guys, you know, it's the elite against America,
right?
And it's elite against the world for control of everything, as far as I can tell. And Alan Dulles is just the most fascinating character. He died in 1969. There's interesting stories about his death, but I don't. It's kind of a little sordid. These guys who are, tend to be used by Satan tend to die very, very in a very ugly manner. And Frank Wisner was head of covert ops. He was absolutely stark raving mad when he died. Likewise, James Forrestal, Secretary of the Navy or something like that, very powerful. He was totally bonkers when he died. I mean, their life karma, if you will, you know, is so overwhelming towards the end of their lives that it's a total disaster. The story on Dulles, I guess I'll tell it. Tex Mars tells the story. There was a big party at the home of Alan and Clover Dulles. Clover, his long-suffering wife, and he had, you know, hundreds and thousands of, you know, liaisons with other women, and he'd write home to her about it. And this is all detailed in Talbot's book, or at least some of it is. And but interestingly, I don't think Talbot tells this story. Again, limited hangout. But he was failing. He was upstairs in bed. Clover has a big party with all the Illuminati, the glitterati, the power players in 1969 in the D.C. area in Georgetown. And Clover is in a very upbeat mood, looks really, you know, well-dressed and, you know, wonderful hostess. And people keep asking about Alan. Oh, he's got the flu. He's upstairs. Don't worry. You know, he'll be all right. Well, some of Alan's friends go upstairs to say hello, and they see that he's rolling around in his own, you know, pee and feces.
Yeah.
Mumbling, you know, he's losing his mind. His wife is so disgusted with him, she won't even, you know, change the bedclothes.
Right.
And then one of his employees, who actually must have liked him, said, "Okay, this is not good. We're going to bring him to the hospital."
Right.
So they wrapped him up in a bunch of bed clothing, brought him to the hospital, where he died a few months later. But you know, I mean, can you imagine the humiliation that he must have put her through?
To imagine the type of society that they live in, the type of parties that they have, the type of associates. I mean, it would be a real stretch for any of us normal people to even put the, eyes wide shut is the thing that I always think of when I think of the elite parties, because, you know, they're ritual sessions too. You know, it's not just fun and games and sex, which is, I guess a lot of it is.
But if I could comment on that, Paul.
Yeah, I'd like it.
I think there's an intermediate level. I think that the eyes wide shut thing is really, yes, for the elite, and that's the real dark secret side. I think there is a kind of a public side that has to do with these parties, in which you don't see that. You don't see the masks. You don't see the rituals. But there is an awful lot of, you know, hobnobbing and charming. Supposedly Alan Dulles was very, you know, engaging and charming. And yes, it would be hard for us to imagine it, but actually not so hard for me, because I grew up in the Washington, D.C. area. And there's some connections in my life to this world. I won't go into it, but it's a very sophisticated, actually fun. You know, people are, you know, witty, gay, having fun. And, you know, great parties and so I think Alan Dulles was, this comes across very well in the movie, The Good Shepherd, where they show these gatherings of the skull and bones. You know, I mean, the bushes are from skull and bones.
Yeah.
And yes, these are satanic societies, but they have their parties, and it's all very sweet, or apparently sweet. You know, they get the minister up there, you know, praying for the interests of the people involved, and And it's there is a level of in at which these guys are the good guys, and they're doing good in the world.
Well,
and you have to go a little deeper to find out that, you know, this is just not true. I mean, what they're doing in the world is extremely destructive, but they are protecting their own, and I guess they can rationalize it that way.
I think that's real important. It's important for me to know about that, that there's this other, social level where they hobnob with one another, and there might be people outside of the cult involved in this, correct?
Yes. Yes, and it's hard to know exactly who's involved in the cult, but the cult has its tentacles out.
Right.
And I think Anthony Sutton is real good on this in his book on Skull and Bones. He kind of draws concentric rings like an onion.
Uh-huh.
And each of these organizations is like that, with an inner core, and then circles outside, like the Council on Foreign Relations, let's say. You've got your inner core, 6,000 people. The inner core might be 30.
Right.
And then you've got your outer core, which are very highly respectable, successful representatives in academics and in the media and in you know, corporate
right.
world. And they don't really know everything that's going on in the inner circle.
Right.
So, I think that this is the structure of a lot of these organizations, so that, you know, not everybody in the CIA is bad.
Right.
But at some point, you know, they're going to perhaps, if they have a career in it, they're going to get wind of activities.
Right.
And at some point, they're going to make a decision, wow, that's awful. We killed Kennedy.
Right.
That's bad. But hey, I've got so much invested in this career and my retirement and my family,
right.
blah, 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 that I'm not going to blow the whistle on it. And if I did, they would come after me, you know. So you have these various levels of being compromised.
Right.
By this system. So where does the cult start and end? Well, you know, the people that are compromised can't talk about it.
Right. Right.
So that's what I see. I mean, like the Manhattan Project was secret, you know, with 30,000 people. That was, to make the nuclear bomb during World War II. Top secret, 30,000 people sworn to secrecy. Nobody told anything. It was secret. Likewise, the mind control stuff was the Manhattan Project of mind control.
But the Manhattan Project was a brainchild that was hatched at Bohemian Grove. So the core, what you're saying is the core of these people, they were certainly insiders, certainly eyes wide shut kind of guys. But they controlled, they probably controlled another level through information, blackmail, career. And then outside of that, there's the people like you and I. You know, I've worked for these huge corporations as a consultant, and I certainly had no idea, you know, the bottom line, where they were going with this stuff. I was totally compartmentalized. So
that's a very good point. The CIA is extremely compartmentalized.
Yeah.
So one could have a career in the CIA doing X, you know, liaison to, country Y, talking about foreign exchange, for instance.
Right.
You know, money's at the heart of this thing.
Yeah.
You know, these corporate lawyers that are always in control, or bankers, they're
right.
always control of the CIA, and they themselves will have all their slush funds and their corporate connections, like the BCCI bank, you know, Nugent Hand, all of these, and of course the Iran-Contra and all these networks into the crime world right from the get-go. I mean, this as soon as the CIA was formed, CIA was toppling governments in Italy,
yeah.
and Greece. 48, 49, that's like before CIA was formed, they were doing that. The OSS was doing that. And the Operation Gladio, which was a CIA thing, the P2 Lodge out of Italy, the Lucio Gelli and all these, you know, all these connections with the Vatican. I mean, the connections run so deep across the power spectrum. And yet you have to try to find out where the core is. And I think that the great thing about this particular you know, line of inquiry into the life of Alan Dulles, is you can see where the core is, or at least you can see where some of the most powerful operatives are. You know, if you've traced it to the Rockefeller, Harriman, Bush, Dulles faction, which we do in this article, well, there might be a deeper level, but not a whole lot deeper. Rothschild, for sure. I mean, over in Europe. But does it go deeper than that? Well, maybe powers and principalities, you know.
Right.
The Illuminati families, the DuPonts, the Krupps in Germany. This may be the core of it, you know.
I remember reading about the Committee of 300, and then there are certain people in the Committee of 300, like maybe Kissinger, maybe H.W. Bush, and they called themselves, get this, they're grown-up adults. They call themselves the Olympians.
Right.
So they, I think, were in charge of the Committee of 300. Now, who goes back behind those people? There certainly is another level, but it's behind the curtain.
Well, the black nobility, for sure.
Yeah.
The House of Royals in Britain, for sure.
The Vatican.
For sure.
Vatican. What do you think?
The Vatican is totally, and they get back to this analogy of the concentric circles. I mean, the Vatican can be very dark, but your average Catholic out here can be a very sweet person.
Right.
So in a sense, they're kind of part of a cult network, and they don't even know it, you know.
Right.
And they support that cult network with their tithes or with their contributions, and they don't know it.
That's
so
right.
So I think maybe that's a good analogy for a way a lot of these systems work.
Right. There's often a lot of us who are trying to push back in the New World Order, say, well, there's so many of us and so few of them. Well, that depends on how you look at it. That they control a whole, they aren't a lot of people, but they control a lot of people. I think if that's...
Absolutely. Well, you know, again, going back to some of the interesting quotes, let me give you one on that topic. This is in my, I always have some frontest quotes in my articles. And this one happens to be by Lieutenant Colonel Roberts. Before a joint committee of the Wisconsin State Legislature, he said, "The most secret knowledge, a science which outdates history, is the science of control over people, governments, and civilizations.
Jeez.
The foundation of this ultimate discipline is the control of wealth." Who controls wealth? The Rothschilds.
Right.
Through the control of wealth comes the control of public information and the necessities of life. Through the control of news media comes thought control. Through the control of basic necessities comes direct control of the people. A significant portion of the American public is yet to become aware of the invisible government of monetary power.
Wow. Who did that? What quote?
Lieutenant Colonel Roberts, in front of the Wisconsin State Legislature.
Wow.
You know, so the truth, you know, like Pete Seeger said, the truth is like grass. You know, it keeps coming up through the cracks in the side.
Right.
And the truth is out there, you know. And I love that quote by Thomas Jefferson, you know, error requires the full support of government to support it. The truth stands by itself.
Yeah.
And this is what motivates me, because I feel like, you know, if I can, you know, calibrate and find the truth with, you know, snippets and putting things together, it stands by itself. I don't have to get out there and, you know, eventually it's going to carry the day. Because of nature of the universe.
Right. But the important, you have to realize the important role you're playing. Because there's a line from an old funny movie that I heard a long time ago. How did you learn all this stuff, or how do you know all this stuff? And the guy says, well, it's hidden away in books. And it is hidden away in books. And it takes people like you that are good at research to go in there and dig it out. And as you were saying in the beginning, it's not just read this book and it's true, read this book and it's true. No, you have to triangulate. You have to know who's bullshitting you on this issue, who's making a limited hangout here. And so it's really important that what you're doing, and I'm looking forward to reading your article.
Well, thank you, Paul. You know, I have to interject here on this subject. You know, Alan Dulles was immediately appointed by Lyndon Johnson to the Warren Commission right after the Kennedy assassination.
Of course.
So here's the guy who was probably the CEO of the assassination,
right,
who was now the CEO of the Warren Commission.
Right.
And he went right in there with a book that said, okay, in Europe they have conspiracies, but in America we have lone nut killers. So
yes,
it should have been called the Dulles Commission, because he exerted a lot more influence over the commission. And the CIA actually made it impossible for the Warren Commission to have their own fact-finding team. In other words, they had to use the facts that the CIA had produced for them. So the CIA produces this bogus information, which, you know, says that Lee Harvey Oswald is the lone nut killer.
Right.
Meanwhile, the Warren report was really quite long, and Alan Dulles has supposedly said, well, go ahead and put that information in there. Americans don't read.
Yeah.
Americans don't read. That's what Dulles said. So put it in there. You know, in other words, hide it in plain sight. Hide the truth in these books. And it is in these books if you read. And that's why I encourage people to look at the actual statements that are in this article and others. And that's why I quote others so much, because, you know, at my age, I'm not going to go out and do primary research.
You don't need to.
Yeah.
And, well, this is what makes the political correct movement so dangerous, because all of this information that might conflict with your worldview is going to be summarily rejected because it doesn't fit with your worldview and it could be upsetting.
So
the thought police, we're patrolling ourselves. But I think it's really good. It's interesting to note that the CIA is a full-service agency. They create the bad guys, they kill the bad guys, and then they give you a report on what they did. So, you know, go back to sleep. Go back to sleep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I'm really happy to hear your comments now more. I think I've kind of basically handed over the headlines of what's in here in this article. I think it fits very well with, say, 911.
Right.
Because it helps us to understand that, say, you know, 911 is a CIA operation, CIA,
right,
Mossad, MI6, whatever, some mixture thereof. Global warming, the fraud is disinformation. That all of these things are cover stories that conceal a real story.
Right.
So this is the way the CIA has always operated in and amongst itself, especially in their covert operations. The spy is going to have a cover, and he's going to have a cover story. Well, as the spy agency takes over the entire country, as it has, then we are dealing with a world of cover stories and covers and lies. So just like I quoted Coleman, Dr. John Coleman, it used to be a mixture of fact and fiction, and now we've moved more towards just fiction, just lies.
Yeah.
And it's like the old analogy when I was a kid, you know, that so-and-so is a weakling. He can't punch his way out of a paper bag. Well, finding the truth is like punching your way out of a wet paper bag, you know.
It is.
And it's like we got this wet paper bag on us, which is a bunch of lies. And how do you get out of that so that you can see what's outside the wet paper bag?
Right. It's a process, and it's an interesting process. I'm a psychologist, so I think in processes. Some people have decided that they're tired of being tricked and fooled and bamboozled, and they want to know. Something motivated you in your upbringing to investigate Dulles. I've got to know, this guy has been doing powerful things close to me all my life. I want to know. So you have the wherewithal and the brains to get in there and actually ferret it out and pull this guy out and identify him for what he is. And I think that's really important. And that process is what we need. The process. And I call it the awakening, because people just get, you know, I think we started coming out of it in 2006. But what supercharged us was McGovern's work, McGowan's work.
Right.
My God, we are, nothing's been organic about our lives. Hey, I do have a question. While you were going over, you were talking about the puppeted Cold War that happened most of our lives. We were involved in the Cold War and those bad Russians and have to keep up with them and all that crap. It seems like they were starting to do that again with this threat with Russia and Syria. And then they must have decided that they didn't need the Cold War strategy anymore, so they told Russia to back off. What was your what's your estimation on what was going on there?
Well, you know, Paul, you probably have a better sense than I. I'm so plugged into my research and my books,
right?
And I'm so well aware that TV is a central part of the propaganda system that I don't watch TV at all.
We don't either.
And I don't watch many movies. So in terms of current events, I let things go by sometimes.
Yeah.
I hear about them. I get kind of the interpretation of certain people, which resonates or not. I listen to Tex Mars a lot on Power of Prophecy. And I really like him until he brought on Edward Henry recently, this guy in the State Department who's written some really good books. Who now is advocating the flat earth theory and mixing it up with, you know, Israel did it. Well, that's, again, that's you know, mixing truth
yeah,
and lies.
Yeah, that's right.
Know? I mean, it's like, in fact, somebody just sent me that book about this flat earth coming around. Well, I mean, you know, the Catholic Church fought that battle with Copernicus back in the 1600s, and they lost.
Right.
I mean, we obviously... science has proven a long time ago that we have, you know, Earth's not the center of the universe, like you might believe from the Bible. And and to go back now and have a flat Earth, I mean, that's called poisoning the well. You put this outrageous bit of disinformation in with some truth,
right,
and everything gets thrown out, you know. And now everything that Edward Henry has written, and I've quoted him extensively in some of his books, everything is suspect because now he's championing this ridiculous idea that the Earth is flat.
Yeah.
So it's a kind of this is the game of the intelligence agencies to mix truth with lies, and then it becomes again our job to punch our way out of the paper bag. Tex Mars would have said that Russia was coming in on the side of Syria trying to, you know, threatening to take out ISIS, which was destroying Syria, and the ISIS is a creation of the CIA and the Mossad.
Yeah.
And that Syria was an enemy of Israel and the CIA because it actually threatened to harbor people who were antagonistic to the goals of Israel in the Middle East, which is to create a greater Israel from, you know, the Tigris to the Nile, and that's in the flag of the Rothschild flag for the state of Israel, is to take over the Middle East. And the United States is Israel's puppet now, to the extent that the tail is wagging the dog.
Right, exactly.
And we're the policemen for Israel, and we've invaded, what, 7 countries since 9/11. So this then becomes the real story behind 9/11. The real story behind 9/11, we're given the cover, you know, that it was Osama bin Laden that it was the Arabs. Well, in fact, that's not true. And the real story is that it's justification or pretext to prosecute all these wars in the Middle East, like the Iraq War, where we've killed 2 or 3 or even 4 million people out of 22 million people. That's genocide. And the Afghanistan war, which is now longer than the Vietnam War. I think we've been at war since 2001 in Afghanistan, so that's 15 years, with no real progress except control of Afghanistan and its resources.
Yeah.
And it's, again, it's the great game. Who's going to control Eurasia and the resources, two-thirds of the world's people, two-thirds of the world's resources in Asia. And for some reason, you know, all our military bases are encircling Russia and China now. Gee, why is that? Well, again, control of Eurasia.
Yeah.
And all of this is like right out of the great game. So, again, it's the Anglo-American alliance now with Israel very much involved And Rothschilds created Israel and designed the flag even. So this is, if you want, this is the axis of evil. It's Washington, London, and Tel Aviv. It's not, you know, Iran, Iraq, and North Korea. I mean, these are the countries that didn't have a Rothschild central bank.
Right.
Of course, now Iraq does, you know.
Right. I think your comment is really telling in a couple ways. Not knowing about this or not hearing how the mainstream media is covering this particular event doesn't preclude you from having deep insight on it, because you see them. You see how they work. You see who they are, what they're doing. And so any situation, well, okay, knowing the players, what they're doing and where they're going, here's probably what they're doing. So
And that's true. But also, I have my allies. Tex Mars has a weekly power prophecy program. He was a 22-year Air Force officer. He has written 47 books. and I get his take on it. And his interesting worldview is based on geopolitics, which he's always been interested in since a kid, and biblical prophecy. So you put biblical prophecy with geopolitics. That's his that's his starting point. And well, I don't know that much about biblical prophecy. I'm you know, kind of actually more interested in geopolitics.
Yeah.
But I get both from Tex. So I have some good allies.
That's good.
So rather than, you know, wade through the disinformation in so much of the TV and even so many of the newspapers, nowadays I will find my allies and I'll get the insights from them.
I think that's important. I think we all should be doing that. Hey, this has been a great interview, and I hope that we've been able to characterize what's going on and who these people are behind the scenes and how they've orchestrated just everything that we've gone through, especially with international politics, how the Dulles brothers took out Kennedy because he was favoring people, I guess. He knew too much.
Kennedy, you know, he was a patriot. Towards the end, 9 days before his assassination, he says there is a plot to destroy America being fomented in the White House that I have to tell the American people.
Yeah.
There's so many statements that he made. He was condemning the secret societies. He had made moves to pull the CIA out of Vietnam. Yeah. He wanted to break the CIA into 1,000 pieces and said so. He wanted to, in fact, he did reissue the Lincoln Greenbacks, which was coined not by the Federal Reserve, this private bank owned by the European Bank Consortium, headed by Rothschild, but actually have money printed by Congress, which the Constitution calls for. He had he'd gotten his master's at the London School of Economics. This man knew economics.
Right.
He was a very smart individual. And, of course, he was also played by the intelligence agencies, you know, with his trysts with, you know, Marilyn Monroe and whatnot. These were manipulated for him by them. But anyway, Kennedy was, I think, a little like Lincoln in the sense that, you know, I mean, he was very concerned about the American people. And I don't know so much about Lincoln. I guess McGowan has a whole series that questions everything about the Lincoln assassination. Uh-huh. But Kennedy, to me, comes off as the last president who thought he could
do something,
you know, run the country. And of course, he was offed by the powers that wouldn't accept that.
That's right.
And there's a great Bill Hicks comedy skit who... he was big, I guess, in the 90s and 80s. He said, okay, here's what happens when a president comes into the White House. They take him up to the fourth floor, and they show him the Zapruder film, and then they say, any questions?
Right.
And
that's
Clinton
great.
Says, only one. What's my agenda?
What's my agenda? That's exactly right.
Well, so in other words, we've had figureheads ever since Kennedy. And it was a power struggle. Alan Dulles, you know, won.
Right.
Wall Street won. The city of London won. The Rothschilds won. And this is the American people have been lied to, manipulated, brainwashed into becoming the sharp edge of the American empire.
Right.
I don't think anybody in this country ever voted to say, let's conquer the world so that we can be the empire and kill all these other people.
Right.
This is what happened. Right. You know, starting with the invasion in the Philippines right near the turn of the 19th century, into the 20th century. Since then, it has been, you know, progressively the American empire. And then, you know, it gets captured by, again, the Wall Street city of London, Rothschild, British royal family, Tel Aviv axis, if you will, somewhere by night, well, really about the time of the Kennedy assassination. And George H.W. Bush, total skull and bones, total agentur for the Illuminati. Under George H.W. Bush, he not only gives us the first war in Iraq, which, as it turns out, you know, is Babylon,
right,
and has all kinds of biblical implications for the, you know, the return of the Antichrist and that sort of thing, which is why those interests want to control it and did way back, you know. He also signed off on Agenda 21 of the United Nations back in 91, which would then bring us all into this new world order that,
right.
So you have the soft and the hard conquest of the world. The soft conquest, United Nations Agenda 21, brings us into one world government, one world religion under the United Nations. Then you have the hard conquest, which is all these invasions, just like the neoliberal and the neoconservative.
Right.
So these are different ways to take down the world. Think of a pincer movement, you know.
Yeah.
And these guys are very smart, you know, and one can think, oh, gee, are they reptilians? Are they demons? I don't know, but they're very smart, and they have their techniques, and this, you know, playing countries off against each other, you know, playing ideologies and economic systems off against each other, all Hegelian dialectic stuff,
right.
Thesis, antithesis, synthesis, to move nations in the direction of their one world government, one world religion, which is Luciferian. They've been working at this for a long time.
They have.
And we've done enough studies so that we actually do see the spiritual components to this.
Right.
It's got very human face, and it's got also, I think, some very dark spiritual underpinnings. So
yes.
In that sense, I think finding and sharing the truth is our best defense. Let me just add that it was Alan Dulles who decided that the CIA motto should be, "And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free," right out of the book of John.
Wow.
His father was a Presbyterian minister. But if you look, I think that's John 8:32-33. But if you look at John 8:32, you see that it's taken out of context. And what John 8:32 says, you know, something about following Jesus and his commandments. And then, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. So in other words, he forgot.
Right.
To mention. So there again, the, you know, half a truth is worse than a whole lie. So he took that biblical phrase out of context. It's in Langley, inscribed in the stones, you know, to give
right.
people the idea that what they're doing is holy. But what they're doing is actually not holy at all.
Exactly. Exactly. Well, this
has been very unholy.
It is, and it still is. Hey, listen, we got to end it for today. We're going to have many more of these conversations because Eric is just a cornucopia of information, and he can go in and he can do the research and he can give us all insights that we all really need to have to go forward. So thank you very much, Eric, for coming
thank
in
again. Thank you, Paul. It's a pleasure, and thanks for letting me share this this work. I do have members in the family who've been in the CIA. So you're a psychologist, you're interested in process. And that world tangentially touched my life.
Yeah.
And there is an element of secrecy there that I couldn't learn from talking to those individuals, but I have learned through books.
Yeah, so. Great. That's so. God bless you, Eric, and we'll talk to you another time.
Thank you, Paul, and God bless you.